The world of football with a soccer perspective. This is Soccer Today with Duane Rollins and Kevin Laramee, live on the Sports Podcasting Network.
Good day, good night, and welcome to Soccer Today for Wednesday, January 15th, 2020. I'm Kevin Laramee, joined by Duane Rollins. As always, Duane, how you doing on this hump day?
I'm doing well. It's a mild day here. I always like to give the weather. This is the weather report. It's a mild day here in Toronto. I'm in my room staring at the sky and the lake and dreaming of soccer and sunny days.
Soccer and sunny days, yeah. At least soccer is back in Major League Soccer. Five clubs have started their training camps, and we'll get to it. CBA talks are in progress. We'll talk about this a little bit today. We'll also talk about the green card situation. Atlanta announced yesterday that three of their players are now permanent resident from USA, and we'll talk about the advantages versus the Canadian laws, also about immigration and labor laws and how it's not to MLS's fault and all this. We'll get to it. I think it's a yearly tradition that we give people update on how labor laws are in Canada versus United States and the certain amount of different requirements and special occasion that you can have if you are an athlete in the United States. But first of all, Duane, let's start by talking about Ottawa, the Canadian Premier League, and recent updates since yesterday. Of course, now it's known that there is a project in Ottawa that might be fast-tracked and might be ready for 2020 as the eighth team in the Canadian Premier League with foreign investors. What have you learned since yesterday?
Yeah, I've confirmed what a lot of people are saying on the internet, really, on the internet, on Twitter and so forth, about how there is this foreign investment group that is with ties to La Liga. We don't know who they are. There is a rumor floating around that it's Espanol, the second team in Barcelona. They're owned by a Chinese company called Rostar, but I don't know if that's true or not, or if it's just people speculating and a rumor sort of gathering steam. In fact, I know that there's at least one prominent person saying that it's not that group, but nonetheless, it is pretty much confirmed, A, that it's a team or a group that has Spanish connections, and B, everyone insists you're going to know who it is. So speculate away. Espanol has been out there, as I said. I think there's an argument to be made that it's Atleti, but we don't know. However, we do know that they're there. Yeah. This is a very fast-track situation. They did not approach the league until late November because the league was so excited by the money and the experience with this group. They started to really get down to the nitty-gritty to the point now that there has been a mandate sent across all channels within the Canadian Premier League to shut up, basically. No one will talk. I did manage to get some people in Ottawa yesterday that provided, you know, confirmation that this is happening. They also suggested that the league has given them a hard deadline of January 31st, so that if the deal is not done to get them in play for 2020 by the 31st of January, then the league is going to go ahead with the 17 plan. That was always the plan anyway. They have a schedule that's almost ready to go, but they're holding off and all that in case they have to rejig it, right? Last year, the schedule came out in late February, so it's not a big deal. It's not really that delayed, but they are sort of, they put a pause on it, right? The other big issue is the Canadian Championship, the Voyageurs Cup. The draw had already been made. The selection had been made. How do you fit Ottawa in there? Do you fit Ottawa in there? I think the solution there is to simply say you didn't meet the deadline for application for this, and therefore you're not part of the Voyageurs Cup for 2020. You can be for 2021. I'm sure most Ottawa fans would be understanding of that because this has happened very late. Frustrated by it, but understanding of it, right? So that's kind of where we're at. Whether this happens or not, Kevin, there's a lot of people that are saying very positive things about it. They think that this is close. One report out there suggested that it might happen as early as next week. The people I spoke to weren't quite as bullish as that. They suggested that the talks were positive, but that there's a lot to do in a very short period of time. And that's to say nothing. That's just about getting the T's crossed and the I's dotted for the actual contract to be part of the league. Then you have to build a team because most of the Fury are gone. They don't have players, so they would have to very quickly scramble to get that. I spoke to one person yesterday who said, who confirmed that, or suggested to me that wouldn't be as big of an issue as it sounds, but it's still going to be a bit of a scramble, right? You're grabbing whatever's left. I'm sure there's a lot of PLSQ players that would be that they grab because they're an area that hasn't really been mined that well yet. But it would be a challenge to put a team together in a month. I mean, I think everyone understands that. So these are the complications. But I would say two things to this, Kevin, and then I'll let you jump in. One, I think this is almost certain now that there will be an Ottawa team in 2021. The question is whether it's 2020, and hopefully it is, because I think we'd all like to see a resolution for this that provides Ottawa fans the opportunity to still go out to a stadium and support their local team. Whether that team's called the Fury anymore, we don't know that, but a team in Ottawa nonetheless.
It would be beneficial when we look at the calendar, 18 versus 7, scheduling purposes and equality or balance of the calendar. And for sporting reasons, it would be beneficial. Even number league is always easier than an odd number league. And of course, it's part of the ideology. As you mentioned, we'll know more by the end of the month. And if you want to learn more of what Duane and I feel Ottawa deserves as a team yesterday on the Two Solitude Soccer podcast, which you can get subscribed to for $2 a month, you will hear Duane and I talk about the Ottawa situation, what it could look like, potential candidate that we've heard out there. You can find more on our Patreon page. Let's continue and talk about another situation that does affect players in Canada and the United States, Wayne. The permanent resident situation in Canada and the United States are different. There's different exceptions, but you know, this conversation comes from Ezequiel Barco, Franco Escobar, and Eric Remedy becoming U.S. permanent residents, no longer occupying an international roster spot for a Major League Soccer team. And when we look at Canadian in Canada, there are, of course, known as homegrown or local players, which is not the case in the United States. When you have your permanent residency, you do not count as an international player anymore. And an example in Canada that we can mention right now is Laurent Simon. Since yesterday, he received his permanent residency. TFC player, played for Montreal before, and there's different requirements and different exceptions for both of these. But it is an advantage for U.S. teams because the process is a lot shorter. In not even 2 years, you can get everything fast-tracked if you qualify for the special exception in the state that falls into this category, because you can apply for a green card through employment. And in the employment, at first preference, so the first category that gives you almost automatically your green card if you qualify, is if you may be eligible to apply for a green card as an immigrant worker if you are a first preference immigrant worker, meaning you have extraordinary ability in the sciences, arts, education, business, or athletics. This is why it is easier for Americans to get permanent residency than Canada, Duane, because this process does not even take 2 years in the USA. But if you look at Canada, to have permanent residency, you must have been physically present in Canada for a minimum of 730 days, which is 2 years. Within the past 5 years, it takes a minimum of a five-year process. And you're wondering, well, Laurent Simon hasn't been playing for TFC for 5 years. You're right. But 5 years ago, he started playing for the Montreal Impact. And that's when this process was started. So there's a big difference of time, big time gap between how long it takes for an American team to get a permanent resident for one of their players and a Canadian team to do the same.
No, precisely. In Canada, the athletes are treated the same as Joe Smo, right? You come in, you get the visa to play easily enough because you have the exception for that. But in terms of getting your permanent residency, you're treated like anyone else. And you mentioned Simon. I mean, that's a perfect example. You're in the same day that Simon announces he's a permanent resident in Canada, and he's doing it for his family reasons, not so much for sporting reasons, because TFC doesn't really need the international slots. They don't use them. They're primarily an American team, as many of our Canadian rivals like to point out.
Yes.
It's so they count as domestics in Canada. So nonetheless, it's not a big deal in terms of TFC's roster build, because they don't, like I said, they don't use the international slots anyway, but some, not all. Anyway, it took them how long? Like,
5 years,
right?
2014-15 when he came in. That's 5 years ago now. It's 2020. So that's the perfect example if you want to compare both. And Barco hasn't been old enough to vote for 5 years. So never mind being in Major League Soccer for 5 years. So yeah. That is just an example that says, yes, there's an advantage if you can do it properly. And over the last few years, we've seen teams like Minnesota and, of course, Atlanta use it. A lot of their players were turned into just regular non-international spot player of domestic player because of that exception that you can fast-track a green card process. Now, a lot of fans of Canadian teams in Major League Soccer, Canadian fans are saying it's not fair. Major League Soccer needs to do something about it. It's an advantage that is not surmountable with anything that teams can do in Canada to fix that advantage or that disadvantage for the Canadian team. My answer to these critics is, you're not wrong. But Major League Soccer does not control labor laws in different countries. And that's one of the repercussions of having a league operating in two different law systems.
Yeah, I mean, we talk a lot about this with the Canadian domestics issue, which we don't talk about that anymore. That back in the day was the main thing that I talked about. Probably the It's Called Football, there was no topic we talked about more than Canadians as domestics in MLS because it seems completely unfair that a Canadian player playing in a United States team is not considered a domestic to us. And I still to this day believe strongly that the labor laws would allow that. But nonetheless, MLS disagrees and we have the weird solution that they have now. I do think that the other area, that, you know, we talk about the Canadian teams having a disadvantage. I think that there's no doubt that they do. But at the same time, the Canadian teams do have also access to the Canadian market, which gives them, in theory, a larger market of domestics to attract because they, the Americans, as I said, are domestic. So, you know, you can argue that maybe that counters it, right? However, I think the bigger issue at play here is how this affects all domestic players, whether they be Canadian or American, in terms of their playing time. And this is a philosophical question that MLS has to answer. Are they a development league? Or are they a selling league? Are they a league that just wants to attract an entertainment product that just wants to attract the best players, the best names? And I think MLS wants to be a bit of all of that. I don't know if that works. When it comes to this, Kevin, the solution's pretty simple. Instead of, you just reverse how you frame the rule. Instead of saying you have X amount of internationals, you say you have to have X amount of domestics that have trained in Canada or the United States. That would then give Canadians the same status in the U.S., and it would change it so that instead of, you know, you wouldn't have to worry about international slots, but you would have to worry about making sure you had enough domestics playing. You know, there are some teams, it's no longer news when it happens, but there have been several games in MLS where there haven't been a single American player on the field. I believe there was a game involving the Whitecaps about 3 years ago, and I think they were playing SKC, maybe. I don't remember the opponent, but I know that it was the first time in MLS history that none of the starters were domestic. And is that something that appeals to you, American fans, American listeners? Maybe it does, because there is an argument to say, who cares? It's up to the American or the Canadian player to fight through. I heard that argument. I get it. But I also think, you know, as someone who looks at what the Canadian Premier League is doing, that it is nice to have that domestic or local product there. So it's really a philosophical question. As you say, the rules are different. So I don't get worked up over this. It's just, it is what it is. And I think, as I said, the Canadians, because they do have access to the Canadian market where the U.S. doesn't, say what you want about Canadian players, but they seem to be improving. So that, to me, counters that a little bit. But yeah, it's a topic. It always gets the lips flapping.
No, it always does, and it always feels like an unjust advantage, an unfair advantage, but it's not up to Major League Soccer to fix that advantage. Now, does the Canadian Major League Soccer team have enough influence into government, into lobby? So basically, you would have to hire lobbyists for Major League Soccer team to go to Ottawa or provinces, so either to Quebec City, to Toronto, and to BC, and go to provincial governments, but especially federal governments, because immigration laws are federal, and eventually there's different provincial ones also. So it does become a complicated issue that cannot be fixed by a simple exception law, because there's no such thing as an exception law for doctors, for a dentist, for an entrepreneur coming into with millions and millions of dollars, which those all those examples I just mentioned, these exceptions, exist in the United States. So it's a bit of an offshoot of society, how it works, and your prerequisite to be part of this society. In the United States, you can be part of it, but what you get from being part of it is a bit, well, it's basically based on healthcare. And want to make sure that Canada, it's a bit more difficult to get all the advantages. It's one of the examples, but it is a lot more difficult to get a permanent residency. To immigrate, it's a bit easier to come to Canada, but to get the permanent residency, that is a difficult, and it's a choice of society. So if society as a whole will, in Canada, would like to fast-track doctors, fast-track entrepreneurs, and maybe include athletes, maybe there's a way permanent residency can be obtained in a shorter time span than 5 years. But until then, we're still going to be talking about this advantage in 5 years' time in Major League Soccer.
Yeah, just real quickly, the other side of this is I always laugh when I respectfully laugh when people suggest that X player on their team should get their Canadian citizenship so they can represent Canada. Like, add 5 years at least, add like 7 years to their age if you want to do that, because it's just not really that feasible and it's probably never going to happen.
Remember when Camilo was good in Vancouver in 2013 and people were like, yeah, cap Camilo. Well, he would have made his debut last year for the Canadian national team.
Yeah, no, it's not a short process at all, and it's very difficult. I mean, look, the cynic suggests that there are always exceptions to these things, and if you think back to Alphonso Davies, they did kind of fast-track that a little bit, although not as fast as people would have thought for a player of his skill.
It's only because he was here as a teenager. He literally just fall into a situation where it was easier for him to get it because he was here for a different period in his life than normal workers would come in. He falls into a different category as a refugee, and he would have had the same thing actually in the United States. There is such a category as a Liberian Refugee Act in Canada, which is why this fast track of Alphonso Davies was possible, which had nothing to do with the fact that he's a soccer player, an international star, and a big name for the country. It had to do from his refugee status before and how he actually immigrated to Canada.
Fair enough. Yeah. So look, it's the laws of the law. And I think there are listeners out there. I suspect that most of the listeners, most of the people that follow Major League Soccer would respect the idea that these players have to go through the same process as any other person trying to move to the country. I think that's fair. I tend to lean that way. I tend to think that the Canadian way is the better way. That's not because I don't want people to immigrate here. I clearly do. I think immigrants have a great value to society and we should have more of them, but that's a political statement that I'm not going to go any deeper into. But nonetheless, I do think that when it comes to this, which is essentially, you know, access to everything, when your permanent residency is means you're pretty much Canadian. The only thing you can't do is vote.
You can't vote and you can't put yourself up for an office of an official role in a government position.
Yeah, but everything else is the same rights as Canadians. You have access to healthcare and all that stuff. And when you talk about Samal, for those that don't know, he has an autistic child. And one of the reasons he came to Canada was because the autistic services here are much greater than they were in Belgium or France where he was, right? So that's why he's here and that's why he wants to stay here. So yeah, he has that access now, and whether he wishes to continue on to get the full citizenship, but that's a question that he'll have to answer himself and a personal question therein. I mean, there have been incidences where Canadians have, there are players that have come to Canada have stayed and become residents and become citizens. I think Dicchio became a citizen a few years ago, for instance.
Asun Kamara of the Montreal Impact, former defender, now he also has his citizenship. So there's a few instances in the soccer community in Canada that you can point to.
Yeah, and that's a personal choice that they're making, and they're providing, you know, in Dicchio's case, he's coaching the TFC Academy. So they're continuing to add to the Canadian scene. But yeah, we're getting into politics now, really, is when you're talking about immigration policy. But as it relates to Major League Soccer, an international slot, particularly for a team like Atlanta, is a valuable thing. And they have very effectively done this. They have very effectively worked with the rules to allow them to have more and more Latin flair. I mean, you look at Atlanta's lineup, and they're practically, it's half of it South American. And that's the philosophy that they went. And it's been successful for them. And now they have a couple more spots that they can use to likely bring in more players that fit that mold.
Yep, no, it exactly is, and it's not a by coincidence. It's a lot of work from front offices in Major League Soccer and the American teams that are able to facilitate this process, which, unfortunately, in Canada, we can't. So, here we go. We're going to take a small break and come back and talk about more law-related issues. Yes, it's the off-season. A lot of things are in flux. One of them is the collective bargaining agreement, and we'll talk a little bit about it after this short break.
You are listening to Soccer Today. Follow us on Twitter at Soccer Today SPN and like our Facebook page, facebook.com/ Sports Podcasting Network. You can find the podcast version of all the shows we do on iTunes, Apple Podcast, Google Play Store, TuneIn Radio, iHeartRadio, and anywhere you get your podcast.
And we're back on Soccer Today. I'm Kevin Laramee, joined by Duane Rollins. As always, you like to hear about Canadian soccer? Well, on our Patreon page at patreon.com/sportspodcastingnetwork, $2 a month will give you access to the Two Solitude Soccer podcast, which came out yesterday. $5 will give you access to the ESPN Extra tier, where breaking news audio, Soccer Today Presents, and Five Rings Extra are available. And our $10 tier will give you access to a new documentary before the beginning of March. You also have access to the documentary of last month. 6 documentaries a year, one every 2 months, will be available in a documentary tier at patreon.com/sportspodcastingnetwork. This should be one day a subject of a documentary, dear, when we have, collective bargaining agreement, and apparently it's going well. An article on Yahoo Sports by Doug McIntyre, which will be on the show tomorrow, gives us a bit more insight in what transpired late in December. Apparently there's been a breakthrough during negotiations, and since then things have been running smoothly. You can read more on Yahoo Sports on Doug's article, where he talked to Evan Bush yesterday, who is the CBA representative for the Montreal Impact. So apparently it's going well, but, you know, CBA negotiations always go well until they don't.
Yeah, it's a good sign that Evan Bush was quoted directly rather than sources say or someone close to or whatever, right? So that suggests to me that that's the message that the MLSPA is looking to get out there. And that's a positive thing, as I said. Look, the way these negotiations often go is they start with the easy stuff and work their way to the big stuff. Because that, if you start with the hard stuff, you're going to get ill will in the room right away. And that makes it difficult to get anything. If you start with an easy thing, then people start to go, okay, we're working together here. And my take is that MLSPA has thrown out, you know, they've been throwing that bone for a while, the flights. Give us more flights, give us more flights. And I think that that's one that the owners and especially the GMs are okay with and would hope that they can maybe get. And I suspect that they've made some concessions there already.
Yeah.
All right, we're going to deal with the flights for you.
We'll give you more than 6, but we're not giving you, whatever the case may be, 18 or 19.
Yeah, so I think they probably dealt with that a little bit, and something like that. There's been a concession that the owners have given. They've thrown a bone, basically, and that gives the players a good headspace when they get to talk about the big stuff, which is compensation, free agency, and the rules. And the rules, to me, are going to be the sticking point. Are the players willing to strike over TAM? Because it might come down to that. That might be the biggest difference.
Is TAM the hill players are willing to die on?
Yeah, and I suspect they won't be.
Like, you know what? The more I think about it, yeah, okay. It's fine. Just keep TAM.
Yeah. I mean, maybe what will happen as a compromise there is there might be, like, God help us, as you mentioned the other day, another acronym. There might be a domestic TAM.
The DAM. Yeah. The domestic allocation national money, the DAM, monetary, whatever, call it.
Something for veterans, which would also play into the free agency thing. If they've provided a pool of money that can be used for MLS players that have played more than X amount of years and have reached a certain age that they then have access to provide this extra money above the salary cap, something like that.
So instead of clarifying and making the rules easier, let's just add another one. Let's call it the DMV. Everyone loves to go to the DMV, right? So the domestic Major League Soccer veteran tier will give you free agency kind of over 23, only with teams that starts with an A and a C, I don't know, something like that, because that's the rules seems arbitrary at that point.
Yeah, I mean, look, they like to have these pools because then they can control who gets the money. And they have a little bit of control over who's coming to the leagues. The reason the league likes TAM is because TAM is set up to basically go after Victor Vasquez. It's set up to go over players that add considerable value on the field to teams. But again, it's not very advantageous to the domestics. And a lot of what MLS does has moved away from a league that is helpful to American players in particular, and Canadians. We'll loop them all together. I actually think the Canadians are a bit better off, to be honest with you, than the American player right now. And I think that that's where this desire to strike comes from, is that the American players, I think, are feeling that they aren't getting a fair piece of the pie in terms of compensation and movement, particularly movement. I mean, internationals have kind of a choice because most of them are coming from outside and they can choose to negotiate with what team they want to, whereas the domestic player, right from the time especially if they've been around for a while, right from the time they came in, were drafted. And then they've been traded and they've been thrown around and their life's been turned upside down, and they want a certain degree of control over where they live. And I get that. Oh, I mean,
makes sense.
When I'm 18, it's fine to throw me wherever. Oh, Nashville, great. I'm going to learn Nashville. But when I'm sure. 32 and I have two kids, no.
You're 32, you got two kids and you hate country music? You ain't moving to Nashville.
No, probably not. Life for Nashville has a good rock scene too, but we'll see. I want to go to Nashville this year.
Country is not what we think of country, I guess. Also, which is,
yeah, you know, true country is. Yeah, I can. I'm okay with that. But yeah, not my first choice. But
George Strait. We should listen to some George Strait or maybe what are the names? I don't know. So apparently, Garth Brooks is not like real country. Oh, I just said blasphemy on the show. Sorry, country fans out there. But no, but it is when you look at the CBA. And you look at we'll talk about it tomorrow with Doug. There's also one thing that I think is going to weigh heavily in these negotiations is the good faith aspect, which right now seems to be present. And they're willing to have the training camp and go all the way to play the CCL and in good faith because they're seeing the progression and they're seeing the agreement. Right there. They're seeing the path to an agreement. And until that changes, yeah, I think we might be okay for a work stoppage for this year. Because if players and if an official representative of the MLSPA talks to a journalist and says, we can see a path to an agreement, I do believe that maybe it's time to call it. But it's January 15th. I do not believe we'll have a work stoppage the way things are going.
I think the CCL is a major player in this. I believe that the players have a desire to not force a work stoppage until all MLS teams have concluded the CCL because they understand as players how much that would affect that competition and how much it would affect the possibility of them being sanctioned from that competition moving forward. I know not all the players love the CCL. There's some very high profile players that quite have publicly said they hate playing in the CCL. So it might not be that big of a deal, but I do think that at the upper leadership, they understand how chaotic that would be. And also there's just an element of wanting to compete for the players that are there, right? You wouldn't want to lose, especially if, you know, let's say one of the teams is in the final and like a week before the final, there's a strike vote. I'm thinking that team might be like, can we just wait a week? So I think the CCL is probably a big factor in here in terms of timing. I'm not prepared to say there's no strike yet. But as I've said many times before when talking about this issue, you know, this is billionaires versus 100,000-aires. You know, we always say billionaires versus millionaires. When you're talking about other sports, this is 100,000-aires. Yeah. So it's even a greater disparity in terms of the ability to wait things out. And I think they're better prepared now. I think they know they're better prepared now, but that strike fund is not going to pay the bills the same way that they're used to. If you're making $300,000 a year and suddenly that's you're coming in at $2,000 every other week or something.
Yeah,
it's going to be a bit of a challenge.
A bit of a challenge, yes, but we'll have more in the next few weeks when the CBA gets more traction and more negotiations take place. And who knows, we might have an agreement before long. But on that note, we'll say goodbye for today. We'll be back tomorrow with another edition of The World of Football with a Soccer Perspective. You can follow Duane on social media at 24th Minute, myself at Kev Laramee, and this show at Soccer Today SPN, live Monday to Friday, 11 a.m. Eastern, 8 a.m. Pacific, 4 p.m. Greenwich Median Time. And as always, until tomorrow, we wish you, of course, some FA Cup replays today so you can have some fun watching some football, which means you can have a great soccer.
You can find the podcast version of all the shows we do on iTunes, Apple Podcast, Google Play Store, TuneIn Radio, iHeartRadio, and anywhere you get your podcast.